We'd like to welcome Janet Paulsen to Jazz Is. Janet's passion is singing, and welcome.
Thank you, Terry. It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me on your show.
And nice for you to join me today, Janet. Of course, let's talk about, first of all, you. Oh. I mean, you're going to be here at Lyriodendron, I believe it is the 16th?
The 16th, right. That's right.
And you got a big show coming up there, but let's go behind the curtain and find out more about you.
Wow.
Okay. Tell us, for example, starting off with your music journey, your vocal leads journey, give us a little background. What type of influences did you have? And we'll also kind of dig a little bit deeper with Rosemary Clooney a little bit later in the show.
Absolutely. Well, my journey started off, I always loved to sing. And then I actually went to school for singing at Carnegie Mellon in Pittsburgh. And I actually went the route of opera. Okay, because I had a nice lyrical voice and I was lucky enough to tour, you know, some opera. And then, you know, life gets in the way sometimes after a while. And so I took a break. Mm-hmm. And then after the pandemic, I thought, you know what I'm going to do? And my girlfriend's like, why aren't you singing? Why aren't you singing? I mean, I always kept singing, you know, they were for private events or whatever. But I kind of really made a transition to jazz. And I looked at Barbara Cook videos. I mean, because she was a great person who made that change to the Great American Songbook. And I love the Great American Songbook. Yeah. I mean, who doesn't? I mean, it's fantastic. And then through my journey becoming this jazz singer, I was very lucky to hook up. I needed a pianist. And the pianist who plays quite often for me is Anthony Pacetti. And he's actually with the United States Jazz Ambassador Program. So he's in the Army. But we have a great time, and he helps me, like, we sometimes play around with the music and, you know, like, different rhythms and all. So that's been wonderful. I've been with him a few years already, and I just love it. But another big influence on me, and I needed somebody to really, you know, as singers, we're very vulnerable. You know, we're up on that stage. Everybody's looking at you. You go to different things. People critique you. You know, you want to sound like maybe a certain jazz type singer or whatever, but I had a coaching with Jane Monheit, who is now my friend, my mentor. And she's there, Janet, you know, you have a beautiful voice. Just sing it. Just be you. And that was great advice. Yeah. And she said, you know, because what I'm really into is the lyrical quality of the line and also the words. And I also love doing shows because, you know, some people may say cabaret. But cabaret isn't a type of singing. It's just that because it's a show, and we add a little bit more words and tell a backstory, so right. Which leads us back to Rosemary Clooney. So,
well, that's great words of wisdom from Jane.
Oh, yes.
She's a very talented individual herself. And, you know, you talk about the style and the sound, whether it's pared down to just trio or you got a big orchestra that's out there. Here's a question I usually ask my guests. Who are vocalists? What do you prefer? Do you like a larger backing, like orchestra, or you're at home with a smaller quartet trio, or does it make a difference? Sometimes it doesn't make a difference.
It doesn't make a difference. It depends who you're up there with, and if you're getting that energy from the other musicians, especially as a singer. You know, if I look on the stage and I'm just with Anthony and he's into it and I'm into it, that's a magical moment. But I'm blessed because I also get to sing with an orchestra, an authentic 1920s orchestra. And it's just magical with those guys, too. You know, it's just, it's fantastic.
Yeah. So. Now, you mentioned Rosemary Clooney.
Yes.
Why is she one of those individuals? I mean, great voice, great talent. The Great American Songbook interpretation that she brings is superb. What is it about her style that attracts you as a vocalist?
Great question, Terry, because you know what? This show is a passion for me. Because, you know, you listen to a lot of different people. Like I say, I identify with Jane. She's from this era, obviously. But Rosemary, she had this beautiful quality to her singing. Yet she did all, I mean, she's done so many recordings, and I listen to them, and it's just, it's amazing, her voice, her interpretation. And I identify with her. She sings a lot in B-flat, which I do too. but I just love her voice, and it touches my soul. And then, of course, her backstory, which I talk a lot in the show. So if people buy a ticket, which there's very few left. They'll hear a lot of just like backstory that maybe you didn't know. And she, as a woman, I'm so in awe of her, what she was able to achieve with the hardships of her life. And you know what? She kind of had a happy ending in her life. So it's kind of cool.
Yeah.
But yeah, Rosemary is such a talent, and I just, I'm happy. And another inspiration for the show was, I love the movie White Christmas. That was great. And she did a great job in that. But I, Love, You Didn't Do Right by Me, that mm-hmm. song. And she comes out with that black dress, and it's so beautiful. And the way she sings it, and I sing it in the show, but, Anthony and I, we don't mess with it. There's sometimes a song that's just done so beautifully, and I try my best to mm-hmm. replicate that the way she sung it. Yeah. But here's the other thing. I had that beautiful black dress that was designed by Edith Head on the movie White Christmas. I had that made. So I'll be wear that dress.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's
so
impressive.
It's pretty. And I try to do my hair, and I try to have that ambiance of Rosemary. Mm-hmm. And I think the audience really enjoys it.
Well, obviously you have, that showmanship that comes along with your performance. In terms of connecting with your audiences, how are you received?
I really like that they pay attention to mm-hmm. when I'm speaking about Rosemary. They're very complimentary at the end of the show about the quality of my voice. Mm-hmm. And so, but yeah, it's nice. They seem to really enjoy. And sometimes they'll have a question about Rosemary, or I'll send a question out. Obviously I'm not going to, it's not a lecture. Mm-hmm. It's just, little tidbits in between the songs, and, mm-hmm. and they're paying attention. And that makes me as an artist feel really good. Or if I look out there and I see if I'm singing something very passionate, and I see, that recognition of the song and the shaking of the head and just, the eye connection sometimes. I love it.
It's a beautiful thing. And, of course, bringing Rosemary Clooney to life at the Liriodendron at the mansion is going to be phenomenal.
It is going to be phenomenal. And I'm very excited because it's not just going to be Anthony on the piano. Mm-hmm. I also have Frank Russo on the drums, who's super talented, and Sean Simon on upright bass. So we're having the quartet, so that's fantastic.
Wow, that's neat. Do you have a challenge finding the songs you want to perform for a given program?
Sometimes it's too many. Rosemary, she only recorded, it's like hundreds of albums there, to go through. So the challenge is paring down sometimes, right? Mm-hmm. And then also, you want to have it kind of like to tell the story mm-hmm. of some kind of story.
Right.
So to put that together, because I curate it, it's like curating a show.
Right.
So I have to sit down and say, well, what do you start with? What's in the middle? Where do we go from here? Mm-hmm. Then sometimes I like to take two or three songs to make like a medley, that type of thing. Cause she did some of these novelty tunes. She wasn't, Mitch Miller was really big back in the day doing these novelty tunes, even Frank Sinatra. And they all kind of protested though. Although later in life, Rosemary said, well, those made her a lot of money. Mm-hmm. So she wasn't so mad. But we kind of do a little medley of some of those. Like, come on, my house of mine. I love that. Yeah.
So will you be performing both some of her pop?
Oh, yeah.
As well as jazz?
Mm-hmm. Well, yes, definitely.
Should be interesting.
Oh, yeah. It's great stuff.
That's fantastic. And my guest right now is Janet Paulsen, and she's joining us here on Jazz This Morning. And Janet is going to be performing at Liriodendron. I'm trying to find information in front of me here to let people know.
Well, it's going to be Friday, February 16th, 7 p.m., and I was just over there for a tour, which the grounds are spectacular. Mm-hmm. It's a hidden gem. It's just gorgeous.
Right.
There are just a few tickets left, so if you're interested, really try to get on their website and get the tickets.
Absolutely. As it says here, seating is limited. I mean, really limited.
It is limited.
Yeah. And so doors will open at 6 p.m. Refreshments will be available, of course. Tickets are $15 for adults, $10 for children, 12 and under. And like I said, get those tickets, because if you don't, you're going to miss out on a fantastic performance and joyful song, a tribute to Rosemary Clooney. Right now, Janet, what we're going to do is we're going to play a selection from your latest extended play, or EP, as we say in the business. This time, it's Love. And we're going to hear I Only Have Eyes For You on Jazz Is at 91.1 WHFC.
Are the stars out tonight? I don't know if it's cloudy or bright, 'cause I only have eyes for you, dear. The moon may be high, of people go by, but they all disappear from view, and I only have eyes for you. Fly me to the moon, let me swing among the stars, let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars.
That is really a great, great rendition of a great classic here. Mm-hmm. I Only Have Eyes for You. And joining me this morning on the program is Janet Paulsen. She is going to be at Lyria Dendrum for her contribution and actually her performance, A Joyful Song, A Tribute to Rosemary Clooney.
Yeah,
it's going to be an exciting show, a combination of her pop and jazz repertoire. And, well, you also mentioned before we started taping today that you're going to be down at the Keystone Korner.
Oh, yeah.
That's coming up.
Literally, I got a phone call from Todd Barkin. We were just speaking a couple hours before the show. And, you know, I'm a big advocate. I did a show last year in April. April 30th is International Jazz Day. Mm-hmm. And Herbie Hancock is really instrumental in bringing this day of recognition of jazz around the world. Yeah. So I was talking to Todd, but we're actually going to do it one day later. We're going to do May 1st, which is fine. You know, it's, a party is a party because Keystone Korner is also celebrating 5 years here in the Baltimore area.
Yes.
So
yes.
I will be performing there with the Hotel Paradise Orchestra. It's a 1920s orchestra. I think I mentioned it a little bit earlier. We only do music from the 20s and early 30s.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the Roaring 20s. It's great music. We feature, you know, U.B. Blake was a great composer from that era. We feature songs by him, Ellington, the Gershwins. By the way, it's the 100th anniversary of Rhapsody in Blue.
Oh, what a beautiful composition.
And one of the songs I sing with the orchestra is, you know, it's a popular song. It's a Had to Be You. It's celebrating its 100th anniversary in May, being written. So we're going to be there. And the orchestra, when I say that we only do this, we present it in the style. It's an authentic sound from the 1920s and 30s.
Mm-hmm.
And what I mean by that is our orchestra, it's not just horns and saxophones and drums. We also have tuba. We have violins.
Yeah.
And we have banjo.
Nice.
Isn't that cool?
Yes.
So this is when you think about it, like when George Gershwin would write something or U.B. Blake, and they went out on the day, that's how it was presented in those types of orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
So being International Jazz Day, to have sort of that authentic sound is kind of cool at Keystone Korner. It's something different for them. But you know what? I think we're going to have a good time.
Yeah,
it's
sounds
be a party.
Like it. Yeah, it sounds like it's going to be a great party. And I like what you said, you know, because it kind of talks about what jazz is all about. It's the feeling in the noun that you have when you're performing. Mm-hmm. And what a great tribute to a great art, jazz, you know? A little misunderstood, but it's still here.
It's still here. Still
and
going.
And one of the really nice things I was telling you earlier is with jazz, there are so many what we call schools, you know, of jazz.
Mm-hmm.
But yet you can take a single song and hand it to an artist or a performer within that school, and you'll get a different interpretation.
Every time. Only
music.
It sounds great.
Yeah, only music in the world where that happens, which is really a great thing. And of course, Janet, you know, with your tribute to Rosemary Clooney, that is going to be just great music, too. You'll have plenty of her music, you know?
Well, it's all things that she's recorded, you know? And as I said, I like to, in the show, is we kind of talk a little bit about her. It's not that I'm sitting there doing a whole biography, but a lot of the information I got from her autobiography, which is Girl Singer. Mm-hmm. So it's fun to read some of that. And then, of course, you know, I did my own little research and background. And then everybody always asks, well, now, George Clooney.
Oh, here we go.
here we go.
I was going to ask is George going to be there?
Yeah, well, I wish. but I don't think so. But George Clooney was her nephew. Mm-hmm. And her younger brother, Nicky, who is still living, he was a broadcaster, okay?
Really?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so, but that's Nicky's son, and he was a pallbearer at her funeral and all that. And, you know, remember when I used to do that show, ER, she made a guest appearance and all. Yeah. They're a tight family. They were a very tight family. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, she had a couple of sons, right?
Well, she had five children.
Five children, right.
Yes,
right.
Some girls and boys. And, yeah, I can't believe that Rosemary Clooney had TV shows going on when she was pregnant and five kids and trying to get back her figure and these are little backstories that I have to tell at the show. So
well, that's a great those are great stories there. I'm interested in the black dress.
Oh yeah, the black dress is great. And then I even one of the things too with Edith Head, this famous costume designer on the set and everything, she had the beautiful black dress on, the long gloves, and then she said she needs something. And she ran in the back and she put a pin on her backside, like a sparkly rhinestone pin. Mm-hmm. So I have that too.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
Wow. That sounds like a lot of fun. And Janet, before we leave, any other projects coming up? I mean, we talked about Keystone Korner, of course. Any other performances that are coming up in the area?
I do have another performance coming up in Annapolis of the Rosemary Clooney Show. That's going to be at Maryland Live.
Yeah.
And that's a great location. And then a bunch of other little private events, places that I'll be performing it. But I also have a new show premiering in March.
Ah.
And it's going to be It's a Lovely Day Today with Doris, Dinah, and of course, the fabulous Ella.
Yeah.
And there's a connection there. But you know what? You'll have to learn about that when you buy a ticket to that show.
Buy those tickets, folks, right? Well, Janet, it really has been a pleasure having you join me this morning on Jazz Is here at 91.1 WHFC. Hope to see you Friday, February 16th at 7 p.m.
At
Lyria Dendrum.
It's a beautiful location. If you haven't been, it's worth coming out. And, you know, thank them for supporting live music. That's fantastic. Yeah. It's a great venue. So support it in your community here. It's we're so lucky to have it. It's gorgeous.
Yeah. Please do.
And Terry, you do a great job here too at the college. I mean, I'm looking around here. This it makes me have my heart beat. You know, I get excited because, you know, back in school and it's just, it's wonderful.
Well, thank you. Yeah. Yeah. We have a lot of fun with our students, as I mentioned to you before. And our students come, we have students from the music area up here, both classical and jazz. We have students from all over the campus that get involved with radio. So radio is alive and well on this campus, at least. Okay, and we'll keep it going.
And we want jazz to stay alive, too, right?
Always. That's my first love when it comes to music, no doubt about it. I have just fantastic collection at home. Right. But Janet, thanks a lot for stopping by.
Thank you, Terry. Okay. Thank you for having me.
Right.
And thanks to Matthew, who also helped, you know, reaching out to me and organizing this. He did a great job. So kudos to him.
Yeah, Matt does a great job. And again, doors open at 6 p.m. At Lyria Dendrum, and that's coming up on Friday, February 16th at 7 p.m. Please come out. It's going to be great having Music at the Mansion and the Janet Paulsen Jazz Quartet.
Thank you,
Okay,
Terry.
Thanks a lot. We're going to go out with one of your selections from the EP. This time it's Love, and it's called Two for the Road. That's a good one.
It's Henry Mancini's favorite song that he ever wrote. So.
Absolutely. It's a
gem.
Hope
they enjoy it.
All right, Chad. Thank you.
If you're feeling fancy free, come wander through the world with me. And any place we chance to be will be a rendezvous. Two for the road we'll travel down the years, collecting precious memories. Collecting souvenirs and living life the way we please. In summertime, the sun will shine. In winter, we'll drink summer. That you are mine will be a lovely day. As long as love still wears a smile, I know that we'll be two for the road. And that's a long, long summertime, the sun will shine. In winter, we'll drink summer wine. And every day that you are mine will be still wears a smile.